The Harvard University Herbaria is based on the main campus of Harvard in Cambridge, Massachusetts. It is the largest university herbarium in the world, contains about 5.5 million specimens of plants and fungi. It is one of the most important resources for studying how plants and fungi have changed through time and how they've remained the same. And we are using these collections in a very active and dynamic way to understand many of the global change phenomena that are happening around the world. One of the traditional ways in which we study these collections is to understand what is a species. That's really the foundation for thinking about their ecology and their evolution. Another way we use them is to understand where species are distributed across the planet. And increasingly, these are becoming a key resource for understanding the kinds of changes that we're seeing across the last several decades and have been forecasted going forward. So the collections themselves are visited by a whole variety of researchers, graduate students, policy-oriented people that are actually instrumental in delineating areas for protection. And the kind of more public-facing side of our institution really is the glass flowers, which are of course incredibly informative in terms of overall understanding of plant diversity, but also just stunningly beautiful objects of art. How does one set about building a collection of plants and fungi that's 5.5 million specimens strong? It's an enormous collection, and it's obviously been built over decades. One of the ways, obviously, is that we go into nature. We conduct expeditions. People like myself and my research team, we regularly travel to the field. Usually we're searching for particular species or groups of species, and usually what we do is try to make small clippings of plants that are in fruit or flower. Having these reproductive features generally is critical to their identification. And we press them between sheets of paper and then dry them where they're stored safely for centuries. Plants have rigid cell walls that give them a lot of structure and integrity, and they store beautifully long-term in these collections. And then what we do is we mount them on kind of a cardstock sheet of paper with the associated label data that goes along with those. So when we're in the field, we take detailed notes on where the plant was collected, by whom it was collected, when it was collected, are all documented on the biologist's field notes. And then those are transcribed to a label, affixed to the cardstock, and then they're mounted and preserved long term. And increasingly, we'll take a few leaves, for example, so that we can extract DNA from them. We have tremendously important historical collections that date back to the 1800s and even before. So they document really the early history of the distribution of plants and fungi. But in many cases, there are plants in our collections that are no longer present today. And so the only place you can study these species is on these pressed and dried specimens. And the only place where we can acquire their DNA is from these specimens. The early founder, who was Asa Gray, he's sort of recognized as the father of American botany. He himself collected and built these collections over the years. And he had an enormous number of contacts through the network of friends and colleagues that he had sending him materials from all over the world, especially from China, but also from various parts of more tropical Southeast Asia. And that was one way through these networks that our collections were established. Outside of DNA sequencing, digitization is probably one of the greatest innovations in museum science in the last 100 years. In the case of our flattened and dried herbarium specimens, we're taking a photo, we are transcribing the label data, and then we're mobilizing these data online. And if you kind of step back and you think about how people were using these collections 20, 30, 40, 50 years ago, we had to travel from one herbarium to the next to actually study the plants of a region. Today, now that we've got our entire flora of New England digitized, you can access the entirety of collections from New England from your laptop. It's allowing us to do science that we've always done with these collections, identifying species, characterizing their morphology and their diversity, thinking about things like flowering time and how plants are responding to global change. but we're able to do it in a much more large-scale way, putting what we've always done on steroids. But the other thing is it's bringing in kind of new areas of scholarship and new questions into the field in terms of understanding how we might potentially mitigate this grand experiment of global change during the recent past and what we may see going forward in the future.